following interview was conducted with Kenneth S. Curtis for the Purdue University Oral History Program. Took place on Thursday, September 27, 2007, as a residence in Lafayette. The interviewer is Catherine Marquis, the Oral History Librarian. Welcome. Tell us a little bit about your early years and where you were born and growing up.
Well, my father was a chemical engineering graduate from Rose Polytechnic Institute in Terre Haute in chemical engineering, and he came up to Purdue for a master's degree. He was in the agricultural chemistry department, now biochemistry department, and as a graduate student, he met a secretary who worked for Allison Stewart, a local attorney, and eventually they married, and I'm a product of that marriage. And I was born October the 10th, 1925, in Home Hospital in Lafayette, and we lived in West Lafayette all my life. I went to Morton Grade School in West Lafayette Junior High School and West Lafayette Senior High School and Purdue University. And one of my colleagues used to introduce me as being an individual who's had all of his education within a radius of 5 blocks. That's not quite true because I did have a year post-master's in Columbus, Ohio, at Ohio State. But after all, my dad stayed on in biochemistry, and not as a teacher, but in state control work in the state chemist's office and feed fertilizer inspection all across the state. So, you know, I had no choice but grow up, go to Purdue, take civil engineering. I've always been interested in mapping, and I used to, when we went on vacation trips, I rode shotgun with my dad as a driver, with being the one with the maps. I used to collect all kinds of maps as a kid. But anyway, when I finished my undergraduate work, I decided I would take a master's degree. There's no place that had advanced degree in surveying and mapping or geodetic work or grammetry. So I went into civil engineering in transportation and finished up there
here
in transportation at Purdue here with a minor in surveying, a couple of courses in surveying. Right away, I was a graduate teaching assistant for Professor Lamo in surveying. And this was right after the war, the big war, in 47. And so he needed a lot of graduate assistants. In that day and age, all engineering students as freshmen took a course, 2-credit course in surveying. All freshman engineers. They alternated that with a 2-credit course in welding, heat treating, and so forth, alternate semesters. So I was an assistant there, and civil engineering had a summer surveying camp for civil engineers, starting the sophomores took that. And so he invited me to be on the staff at Ross Camp. That was in the summer of 47. And that was the summer we got married. So I wasn't there for the first 6 weeks, but the second 6 weeks, I was off from my honeymoon anyway for a week or two. I can't recall exactly. And then I was on the camp staff in 47 and 48 and 49 and 50 while I was working on my master's degree. And in, I think, about 48, I was given the title of instructor. I don't think they have that anymore. You have to start with a PhD and as assistant professor. But I was an instructor for several years there. And then I decided I needed to get out and get some field experience firsthand. So I took off the summer of 1951 from summer camp. In fact, it was 6 months leave. I left a little early in the spring in April and came back in October. And I worked with the Coast and Geodetic Survey on the ship Explorer, and we were doing hydrographic surveying in the Bering Sea, west of Alaska, north of the Aleutians, and spent 6 months there on that. That was in 51. 52, I was back at camp in the summer, and then 53, we went down to, that's my wife and I, and baby, that time, went down to San Antonio, Texas, and worked for the summer in a photogrammetric firm using aerial photographs and mapping. And I was back on the camp staff in the summer of 54. And in the summer of 55, I worked on a coastal geodetic survey party again geodetic triangulation in eastern Indiana, where they build the 100-foot steel towers and do surveying from that, angle measurement, and also on a geodetic leveling party in upstate New York along Lake Champlain. Then I was back on the camp staff in 56, and in 57, I worked for the RCA missile test project down at Cape Canaveral, Florida for 3 months in the summertime. And then in 58, 59, 60, back on the camp staff. And that's when they decided to bring the surveying teaching back on campus and not have a summer camp. And I think there were at that time then, that's about the time that, or maybe before that, that all engineers didn't have to take surveying. It was just the civil engineers. Keep in mind that the civil engineers take, I think it was a 2 or 3 credit course, followed by another 3 credit course. But then there was School of Technology, Construction Technology, had their own surveying equipment, and they taught a couple of courses in surveying to their construction technology students. Also down on the Ag campus, Professor George Spencer in Ag Engineering taught a 3 credit, maybe a couple of courses to Ag engineers and foresters. By the way, I helped him out when I was a senior in assisting some of his classes in ag engineering and surveying. So when you see surveying groups out over the campus doing surveying classwork, it could be from any one of those 3 disciplines that have their own equipment.
Sure.
At one time there was discussion about combining all of these with common equipment in one school instead of having them taught in 3 different areas, but that never came about.
A couple things, me interject. Can you tell us a little bit about the campus, what the campus was like when you were here at that time as a student? Did you live on campus or did you live
at home? No, I lived at home.
Okay. Did you, any clubs or activities that you were involved
in? Yeah,
this was after the war, so there were a lot of people who were coming back, had been in the war.
Right. I tried to get into, after I graduated from high school in 43, tried to get in the Navy V-12 program, and because of my eyesight and because Doc Miller, Student Health Service, found that I had a systolic heart murmur, I was 4F. And they didn't want me to take ROTC, but I insisted, and I did take 2 years of ROTC in the field artillery. But and then right at the end of the war, I was reclassified a 1AL, which meant limited service. But
classification I haven't heard.
The war ended, and I never was called up.
Okay.
But while on campus, I was with a lot of the V-12 students, Navy and Marine Corps. A lot of my friends served then after they left Purdue. But the number of civilians like myself were very small. But I was a reamer when I was in school, and I worked in the circulation area of the Exponent. I guess I was business manager one summer when the business manager wasn't in summer school.
Did you drive the Boilermaker special?
No, it was going on, but I wasn't involved with the driving of it, but worked with it, of course.
Oh, yeah.
I was very active in the Purdue Christian Foundation, where I met my wife, by the way. And I've still been on the Purdue Christian Foundation board, even yet today.
Very cool.
It has been combined with the University Church, with the Presbyterians and several other denominations. But we don't have a Purdue Christian Foundation house. The university bought it supposedly for a parking garage. It became the Black Cultural Center on University Street.
Oh, that house that was the original?
Right.
Oh.
And then it finally became the new computer building, of course, today.
Can you tell us about on the camp and explain what were some of the programs? And the students had to be there for a period of, 6 weeks or the whole summer?
It varied. Okay. Also, by the way, I was an Iron Key when I graduated as well. But getting back to
your involvement
with Ross Camp, there were so many students involved in going in. There were 200 to 300 students, and they, instead of being 8 weeks long or 9 weeks long as it was in the 1940s. Well, I should say before the war. During the war, that was suspended. The courses were taught on campus. But going back to the 1930s, as I read in history, there were 8 and 9 weeks long.
Also in the summertime as well?
Summertime, right. Right. And then after the war, they became 2 6-week camps. One set of students for the first part of the summer, another set of students for the second part of the summer. And eventually, when we had our land surveying program in the beginning of the 70s, it became a surveying course of only 4 weeks. But that project course in the 70s and 80s was not held at Ross Camp. It was held in different places, sometimes out of civil engineering building, and we would do work for Camp Tecumseh or the Girl Scout camp or things around here. And then we went on down to Tell City and rode piggyback on the forestry camp down there at Branchville and did surveying for the Forest Service down there. But that's in the 70s and 80s. Getting back to Ross Camp.
Excuse me, that's property that David Ross had given, and now that's where his home is up in the hills, okay. For the research, just clarifying.
George Lommel, who was in charge of surveying, many, many years, and who wrote the booklet on the history of summer surveying camp. And I know there's a copy of this in the library and in the Goss Library, too.
Oh, okay.
I might be able to run up, find one for yourself, too. But it goes from 1914 to 1957. I think he retired in 57, and the last camp was 2 or 3 years after he retired. And there was also, for some of the veterans who were married, particularly, since camp was rather limited in housing down at Ross Camp, they held an on-campus camp, so to speak, for the married fellows who were veterans, essentially, had their families on campus. So there were a lot of students going through at that time. Usually, their camp was divided into two courses, one on what was called topographic engineering for 3 weeks, and then 3 weeks on route or route surveying. And the staff is pretty well divided between those two courses. And halfway through the 6 week period, the group of students would trade. I was, I taught on both sides, at least as an assistant during my period of time. The topographic engineering part included a lot of mapping, contour mapping, and the associated control surveying that goes with it, including astronomical observation for establishing azimuth or north on the ground. Route surveying involved extending a route for a highway through and up and down some of those steep hills out there, which made it a little difficult for students setting their surveying tripods up on the side of a hill. There were a lot of interesting things that went on. Harvey Stewart and his wife built a little cabin down on the Ross Camp site, and they used it for a year or two, and then they turned it over to the camp for the faculty to stay. Just a little cabin there, but we'd have 8 or 10 staff members in the cabin. It's still there, not being used, I don't believe. We had eventually, well, there were, before my time and during my time, they needed to do more buildings there, barracks, classroom
facilities.
Facilities. Back in the 30s, late 30s, they needed a swimming pool, and the students contributed their construction work, maybe 2 days out of the camp or something, to build some of these facilities. Eventually, the Purdue Physical Plant took over and was responsible for building some of the buildings. The classroom building, a couple of barracks, and a drafting building as well. But we had a swimming pool. I recall one of our graduate assistants was a fellow from Indianapolis who was a graduate assistant in civil engineering working on a master's degree. He was on the camp staff, and he was a walk-on football player. And the students were always teasing him. And they came down and got him out of the sleeping quarters one evening and carried him up and threw him in the swimming pool. But there were 3 or 4 other guys went in with him. I mean, he was a strong guy.
Yeah.
I remember one night we woke up down in the the sleeping cabin, and there were sheep running around inside. It is a farm, operating farm, and the caretaker down there was the fellow who lived on the farmhouse. And they did have sheep in some fields around there, and students got some of those down in the staff quarters one night.
That's good.
There were a lot of things like that that went on.
Yeah.
G.P. Springer, George P. Springer, he went by G.P., and he's a little short fellow, taught railroad engineering and the route surveying. Little short, and they called him Jeep. And he always took care of the mail. And we had mailboxes out there by alphabet. And when the students would come in at noon for lunch, he would make them all stand back away from the mailboxes until he had them all placed. Some of the students would, you know, once the box or the A's or B's would be there, they would try to get up there, and he'd just back up, and he wouldn't put them in the mailbox until everyone was there. Also, he...
He ran it like the commandant.
Right. And he... another thing about him, too, that I well remember, I was an assistant to him. And he would, the students would be working on a survey, and they're supposed to, at noon, when they come in for lunch, pick up their instruments and bring them into the, what we called the flagpole circle near the mess hall, and leave them there while they were lunch, and then go back out. But occasionally there'd be a student that, students would leave their instrument out in the woods or on the side of a hill, over their stake from the point, and attacking the stake, the plumb bob. Didn't want to have to set the instrument up a second time. And they'd leave it there and then go into the mess hall for lunch. He would invariably, during lunchtime, be out checking, and he would find an instrument that's over the point. He would drive another stake in the ground with a tack in it, and pick up the instrument and move it over there somewhere, way offline, you know. And then the students, and set them up and level it and everything. And the students would come back there and they couldn't make anything work out. He would pull some so-called dirty tricks like that to teach them a lesson, that sure. Don't leave your instrument around. So there are some of them.
I read somewhere that there was a bell out there, the Monon bell, that they found, yes. Somebody arrived on the scene.
He was the only one that could ring it. He rang it for lunch and the evening meal and so on. That's correct.
Okay.
Yeah, right.
Did you have to stay there the whole time? And did the students get any break? Could they come home for a weekend or anything?
Yeah, they had weekends off.
Oh, okay.
Saturday noon, I believe it was, as I recall, Saturday noon to Monday morning.
Okay.
Right. And the staff would take turns staying out there over weekend, and the staff families would come out for Sunday lunch. And the cooking was great because they had women out of Green Hill, farm wives and so forth.
What's Green Hill? Is that a town?
That's a town out probably 3 miles away.
Okay.
Out west of the campus here. And it was excellent food. Eventually, one of the gals in the home economics department was the food supervisor. They made their own pies and chicken dinner every Sunday.
Yeah.
It was great food. Oh. Nobody complained about the food at Ross Camp.
Why didn't, you said 1960 was sort of the end, and why did it have to close? You want to address that?
Well, there's a in civil engineering, there's about 8 different areas of specialization, you might call it. Structural engineering, foundation, soil mechanics, transportation engineering, materials engineering, surveying and mapping. Probably there's about 8 of them. And almost all of those people in there were young PhDs in their area, and they didn't think that surveying was that important to structural engineering and environmental engineering and so on. And maybe 1 or 2 courses on campus would be ample. And at the same time, they were working towards getting more courses in their areas too. So it was eventually a product of a decision of civil engineering faculty to bring it back on campus.
Was the enrollment sort of stable through most of the time, would you say?
Right, except right after the war.
Sure, exactly.
But we never did much property or land surveying out there. And that's what the land surveying profession needed. So during the 1960s, Professor McIntyre and I, he was a product of Kansas State and was hired on Purdue faculty to go to Afghanistan for a cooperative program over there, which was back in the late 60s. And when he came back from Afghanistan, he was on the Purdue faculty and in the School of Technology, and we finally got him over into civil engineering. And between he and I, we tried to get a 4-year degree program in land surveying started, and the officials, Dean of Engineering and so forth, weren't too enthusiastic about it, but the land surveyors out in the state started putting pressure on the university, and I didn't attend the meeting, neither did John McIntyre, but they met with the deans and eventually with the president of the university, and supposedly I've heard that the president said, "Why aren't we doing this? And is it a professional degree program or is it technician?" And everybody agrees it was a professional program, so it should be under engineering and not technology. So it ended up under civil engineering. And most of the surveying was taught in civil engineering anyway. It was a proper place for it. So we eventually got that started, and it's been a godsend to land surveyors.
Sure. You addressed about that course that was started. Well, you had one of the first graduates from that, the bachelor's?
Bachelor's in Land Surveying, 1972. We had three graduates, and it is growing.
Dale Weaver was the first one from Greenwood.
Dale Weaver, that is correct.
Mm-hmm.
That's correct.
All right.
The last I know, he was working for Chicago Guarantee Survey Company in Chicago. Couple others that same year, too.
Yes, and there were a couple of others, but he was the first one that got it.
There might be a couple of things that were, well, one was before my time, and I think it was about 1936 out at Ross Camp. The Purdue football team was practicing out there in September before the season opened, I think, or whatever, and there was a bathhouse in connection with the swimming pool, and the football team was out there with the coaches, and there in the bathhouse there was a water heater, and also gasoline used for, I suppose, working with adhesive taking, and that ignited, and two of the football players were died from that result, and some others were burned, and that's the only time the football team was ever out there. I think it was 1936. Mm-hmm. That just comes from my memory.
Sure.
I think it's written up
in the
Charlotte Long
Book. Right.
Book.
Yeah. Right.
But the 1947, the first year I was there, we were in the lunchroom during lunch hour, and students had come in from the field for lunch. I think it was right after lunch while they were ready to go back out the field. And three of the students had climbed a steel tower, which was right next to the barracks. It used to be a water tank up there on top. It had been taken off because they had other water supply system going. But there was a platform up there, and there was a ladder going up. And I've been up there several times. It's quite a view over the Wabash Valley, and you can see the smokestacks back at Purdue. But these three students were up there on the tower, and it wasn't an exercise at all for anything they had to do for camp. But they were just lounging and viewing, I suppose, like I would, and one of them dropped a tape over the edge, I suppose, to figure out how tall the tower was, and that tape was windy, and it blew over against the high tension line going into camp here, and two of the boys were electrocuted up there on top of the tower, and one was burned. We were in the mess hall, I remember, and all hell broke loose, really. I mean, there were ambulances and fire departments and police, and everybody came out. But that was a very tragic day.
Oh, yes.
Very tragic day. Yeah. And that's written up in George Longwell's book there as well.
It was a good experience being out there.
Oh, yes, I wouldn't give any.
Do you still hear from some of the students?
I see them around the state eventually.
Right.
A lot of them became surveyors or civil engineers that did surveying construction work and so on.
Uh-huh.
Yes, I see them around.
Yeah.
Right now, I'm seeing more of our land surveying students after 1970s than the earlier ones. Yes, it was real
right.
Good experience.
Yeah. They got a couple of awards, too, that land surveyors gave you an award for excellence in the 72. And you also got the Earl J. Fennell Award for American Congress on Surveying and Mapping. He'll be on the tape, too.
Yes.
That's nice.
And when I retired, I got the second award of the Wabash Award. Our meeting was held that year in the Society of Professional Land Surveyors. Meeting was held down in Columbus, Indiana. And that was the year I retired, and they sort of had a retirement cake for me and so on. And Sheila Clinker was there, and Evan Bye had signed the
This was a surprise?
Yes, it was very much of a surprise.
How nice.
Yes. Way back in the 1950s, Professor Camp, C-A-M-P, Wilbur Camp and I, he was on the surveying staff for a while too. We, Michigan had a land surveyors society. Indiana didn't have anything. But we went up to a couple of their meetings in Ann Arbor and Traverse City, and when came back, we started working with Earl McClure over in the continuing education, adult education, I think it was called. And we started having some Indiana land surveyor conferences. And in 1953, the land surveyors attending these conferences decided to start a society. So we have since 1953. And I was sort of the executive secretary for several years. We had started a newsletter. And for 40-some years, I've been the editor of the Hoosier Surveyor, four times a year, quarterly. And I just gave it up this last spring. I told them that's enough.
But somebody else had the experience.
Somebody else, yes.
Right.
And then after a few years there as executive secretary, they started hiring an outside person as an executive director, and they still have an executive director today in Indianapolis.
It's called the Indiana, is that the title?
Indiana Society of Professional Landsurveyors, ISPLS.
Okay.
And they have, well now the State Registration Board requires continuing education units credits, so the annual meeting, which is held in January, is attended by an umpteen number of people trying to get these credits, and they can't hold the meeting anyplace but Indianapolis now. Hotels aren't big enough to handle it.
Yeah, right.
Several years ago, we have a small library down at the headquarters in Indianapolis, surveying books, and they decided to name the little library the Kenneth S. Curtis Library. I think one of the things that they had in mind doing that was that maybe they could get a hold of, when I retire, pass on, that they would get my library. But I still have it in the basement. But we're trying to download now.
Not easy to do.
It's not easy to do. Basement's full of stuff I brought home from, 44 years of teaching and a number of different courses in surveying.
Right.
My wife is not very happy with the way the basement looks. The last time I brought some things home that was still down at the office, I finally rented space out here. Rental space?
Oh, 52?
Yes.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah, well, it's by Payless.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah.
The one there by Payless.
Sure.
But, and I know that some of the equipment that I bought in the 1950s, some of the new equipment then, my predecessor, or my one who followed me, I'm sorry, Steve Johnson, decided to have an auction, silent auction, for the older antique instruments. This was probably be in 94, 95, and the instruments that I bought in the 1950s were pretty well getting to be antiques now. And with the electronic distance measuring equipment and the GPS equipment, things have changed a lot since I retired, just a lot. And at that auction, I bought three of my favorite instruments that I had purchased in the 1950s. I still have them, but they're not really, really antiques that I could take to swap meet, like the one I went to last week in Virginia, because they are really antiques to go back to George Washington's time and so forth.
Way back in time.
Yes. So I still have those, and I don't know how I'm going to dispose of those. None of my 9 grandchildren seem to be interested in, and our kids, 3 kids, none of our 9 grandchildren are seemingly interested in following in my footsteps. So
Lapusee.
Somebody's missing out here.
That's right, yeah. Well, Chauncey Village has certainly changed through the years, hasn't it? Since you're born and raised here, so you've noticed some changes in there too.
Yes. The other, I don't know, two or three years ago, when somebody in the Lafayette Journal and Courier wrote in about the fact that West Lafayette never had a downtown until the new down by the Wabash area. And I wrote a letter to the editor saying, we certainly did have a downtown down at the intersection of Northwestern and State Street. The fire station down there, and the grocery store. And
there used to be a post office there?
Post office was there, and all this. And I said, we did have a downtown. It's not the first downtown.
Right.
Yes, so much has changed. I worked as a student for Follett's in there, selling books and so forth. That whole area in the village is really changed.
Yeah. There used to be a grocery store there on Northwestern when I first came, but it didn't last too long.
Piggly Wiggly, I think.
Yeah, well, there was a Piggly, that name rings a bell, but I remember.
Crossover where?
And there was a Clothiers, the men's, there was a men's clothier, and also Elsalyn, there was a ladies' place there too.
Right. And a long time ago, across the street, where next to the post office, was a Lux and Humphreys grocery store. And there was a Huffman's pharmacy also there.
Oh, wow.
And a Bartlett's pharmacy on the north side of the street. Yeah.
Foster Film was there, someone told me, I understand.
Foster Film was a little bit west of Grant Street, over near where Cranor Building is now.
Oh, okay. Then they must have moved over to where?
Yeah, they did.
Okay.
Yeah, that's right. They moved over there.
Because when I came here, that's where it was.
Next to University
Bookstore. There used to be a gas station there where Ross Hall is.
That's correct.
Because I used to take my car there. It was always difficult getting in and out, but you could do it anyway.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Share with us a few of your activities in retirement. What are sort of things for researchers, what you've been involved in? As a native Hoosier and a native West Lafayette?
Well, we're still active in First Christian Church, Lafayette, Disciples of Christ, and we're very active in the senior citizen group. We call ourselves Serendipity. That's what the group is called. We meet the third Monday of every month for luncheon and some activity, program or something.
Is this the Purdue Retirees Association?
No, this is our church.
Oh, I see it. Was it filling with the church?
Right.
Okay.
Just a couple of years after I retired, the Purdue Visitor Information Center up on Northwestern Avenue needed to open up a kiosk down in the Union Building because visitors couldn't park up on Northwestern Avenue, except very briefly. But they had to park down on Grant Street, and so they would automatically go into the Union Building, and so they opened a kiosk, and I was one of the original kiosk volunteers. I don't know what that was, 84 or something like that, maybe. 94. We used to be over in the corner there by the model, but then the last couple of years they moved us over. I see you go by.
Oh, yes,
while.
I know you recognize me, right? Yeah.
I work only Thursday mornings every other week. So, and there's most all the volunteers are Purdue retirees.
I recognize some of them, and they always wave when they see me go by. Right. Right.
Right.
And then you've been involved with WALA.
WALA,
mm-hmm.
Yes. About the same time, somebody asked me, I think it was Paula Woods suggested to Doug Knowles. Doug Knowles was going to coordinate a program on historic Indiana, and I think Paula suggested that since I was interested in early Indiana Trails that in the Buffalo Trace in southern Indiana, and might get me to be a presenter like you have been. And I did, and that's my first introduction to law, and I got interested in it and said, well, I can provide some other programs as a coordinator. So I've been a coordinator and a presenter, and been on the board of directors for several years, not currently. But I've had a coordinated program for the last 10 years, I suspect.
Very good, yeah.
And we have, just yesterday I attended a meeting in which Mary said there were 175 enrolled for this fall already, of which there are maybe 12 or 14 different courses that people can enroll in. Some of them overlap, but most of them don't.
Right.
So I've been involved with that. I'm a Lion, former president of the Lions Club. That's every other Wednesday evening.
Quite a few activities.
Yeah.
How about any outstanding event in your life? Does something come to your mind? Anything special?
Well, probably. Well, my wife and I had our 60th wedding anniversary this past June.
Congratulations.
I shouldn't avoid mentioning that.
That's very important. I hear that from other people, too. That's very key. Very key.
I think probably 6 months on that survey ship west of Alaska, the Bering Sea, and also we had some graduate students in surveying and mapping from the Army Map Service, the Army Topographic Engineers. Are taking a master's degree in 1 year, finishing up 1 year, two semesters in the summer, and they get a master's degree.